had many ups and downs along the way, but we're still here, still making theatre.
After all the theatres were forced to close last week, very sadly, we didn't get the chance to open a play in Eastbourne prior to a national tour.
So many theatre companies are, you know, if they're not putting out work, they're not getting any money.
The focus naturally and rightly shifted onto those frontline workers, to the NHS staff, who were at the brunt end of things.
I wanted to work, and because I'm old, I think about Alzheimer's and dementia, and this is to help the Dementia Society.
Over the last 15 years, we set the company up, or I set the company up in March, well, not even March, it would have been January 2004. And at that point, I was at university and I had never had any aspirations to run a theatre company. And in my penultimate year, one bleak January day, I came up with the idea of doing some outdoor theatre. And months went on, and by the time we got to July 2005, I put on our first show, which was Twelfth Night, which toured all the way around the UK, went inside, went outside, and has become a legendary tale of misadventure. 15 years later, and we're still doing it. We've had many ups and downs along the way, but we're still here, still making theatre and performing 3 to 4 productions every year. Largely playing sort of 1,000-seater theatres, both in the UK but also in New York. And we have sort of built a reputation as one of the leading touring theatre companies. Brexit had certainly hit us. I think lots of theatres and companies were struggling with a bit of a downturn with the depressing sort of political landscape that had emerged, that certainly cautioned audiences going to shows like ours, which tended to be dramas without huge big celebrity names. But we were really proud of the shows that we were doing, and 2020 was meant to be the year that we turned a financial corner. We had a show by Ali Millis called The Croft, and that opened in January and was touring. Audiences were coming in and it was proving a very successful show. And then we had our big revival of The Habit of Art, which is by Alan Bennett. And that was a show that we did in 2018 with Matthew Kelly and David Yellen, Veronica Roberts and others. And we were reuniting almost the whole cast. And that was going to open the week of the 16th of March in Eastbourne before a national tour, before then going to 59 East 59 in New York to become the New York premiere production of this wonderful Alan Bennett play. And it was all selling well, and that was going to pave the way for a very happy year.
Well, the United Kingdom is now on total lockdown, with Prime Minister Boris Johnson telling folks to stay home and ordering shops to close.
From this evening, I must give the British people a very simple instruction. You must stay at home.
We saw a downturn in ticket sales from the middle to end of February. It held off remarkably late, and even on the week of the 16th of March, we were still strangely selling tickets for both shows, not in big numbers, but you'd have thought it would have been a complete cutoff. But I think news was disseminating slightly slower down to audiences around the country. And it was still a huge shock and surprise when the theatres actually shut.
When we started the re-rehearsals for The Habit of Art, none of this was even I mean, it was probably on somebody's agenda, but not, certainly not on ours. And gradually it got more and more serious. And I think we didn't really believe it until very, very late on that it wasn't really going to happen. People were speculating that it would be temporary or there might be some restrictions put in. And then suddenly it became, I mean, really suddenly, within a couple of days, it became increasingly clear that despite the government's woolly waffle about, you know, make your own decisions, that a decision was going to be made and the portcullis was going to come crashing down.
I was due down in Croydon Fairfield Halls that night. But 5 o'clock, I remember I was in a coffee shop in Haymarket in London, and Boris comes on, you know, the TV and announces that he advises, that was the word, he advises that theatres should close. So what do you do with that advisory notice? But the management at Croydon had gone home for the day and they weren't available. And I think they were run out of Bournemouth, not in Croydon. And it's quite a big decision to close a theatre, but there was no one to get hold of. So the cast had put up the set, they were there. And we were sort of given no instructions. So the cast were one of the very few shows in London that went on that night. Others were able to close a bit quicker, but we went on in a very surreal performance. But I didn't go to Croydon. Instead, the thought hit me quite quickly that, well, we currently have no get out of jail card. I hope that's not meant literally, but we had no chance of getting out of this. But one thing that we still had, just for a very small diminishing window of time, were two productions that were both ready. What they weren't going to have over the coming months would be an audience to see them.
We were still very keen to A, obviously claw back some of the huge amount of losses we knew we were going to incur, but also we wanted people to see our work. The Habit of Art was in rehearsal. They had never even put the show on with this company for this tour. So we had a discussion with Alice, our artist director, about filming the shows, and that had to happen literally overnight.
I thought we've got nothing to lose. So without having any of the rights, any of the agreements yet in place, I called up Tristan Shepherd.
Well, I got involved with the Original Theatre Company because I was making quite a lot of their online content before lockdown. I made behind the scenes videos, trailers for their shows. And just as lockdown was happening, I kind of also did this sort of SOS project of filming A Habit of Art and The Croft for online viewing.
And on the evening of the 17th, we managed in the nick of time to get permission from the Croydon management to film this show, The Croft. And the cast of The Croft, the last act that they did together, still the last time, probably the last time that group of people will be together, performed to an empty auditorium. There was myself and my sister watching in the auditorium, a 1,000-seater auditorium, two people watching, and Tristan's cameras, and they did a complete live version of it. And Tristan and his team, without any camera rehearsals, filmed it on the fly.
Suzanne, oh, please, don't you are unbelievable. I've waited 9 months to spend proper time with you. You can't keep away from him.
He called me.
Liar!
He called me.
No, he called you.
He's still my husband. I answered. I spoke. I tried to speak to Mark. He could barely talk to me right now. Oh, it is hard, Laura. It is really hard.
And then bundled into the car to drive down to Eastbourne to then the following day be in the theatre. We were there sort of from 12 o'clock. And it was a very strange experience because the news, you know, we told the newspapers this is what we were doing. And in came BBC cameras. So we had BBC cameras, we had Tristan's cameras. There was the huge pressure on the fact that this was be the only time, this has to be a one-take wonder. They had to get it right. And they had never done it on this stage with all the lights and sound together. So, you know, the stakes were high. And on top of all of that, you had the fact that they knew that having done this show, they would then be, I mean, cast out onto the streets. I mean, it does sound, it sounds dramatic, but I mean, it's not far from the case. You know, I know that some of the stage management had kind of got gone from being the company manager and were planning the next week to start shelf stacking at Tesco. People didn't know where they were going, when they'd come back. It was a very odd atmosphere.
The model pupils of this world believe that artists have to pay. You've never really paid, have you?
Not paid, I'm dying.
Oh, Ben, death isn't the payment. Death is just the checkout.
I think it was after the dress rehearsal. Like directly after the dress rehearsal, which I think started at like 2, and so we were finished by about 4:30. And Philip France, the director, and our producers from Original Theatre Company came down on stage, and we all sat around in a circle as we would after a run. And they said, it's just been announced. It's just been announced that all theatres and clubs and music venues and so on are going to be shut from tonight onwards. So we were sitting on stage in our costumes, having just done a dress rehearsal, and they shut us down and we were closed.
Alistair and Tom were incredibly honest about the situation, and I don't think they could afford to pay us at the end of that week, but they made promises which they absolutely stood by. And we were paid.
The Croft went down halfway through its initial run, owing, you know, 50% of the tour and its investors, you know, 50% of all their money. And then just, you know, for an even more kick in the teeth, the next tour, The Habit of Art, quite literally shut on opening night. So we'd spent all the money, all the capital to get the show open, and it didn't even perform in front of a live crowd.
Alistair, who is the artistic director of Original Theatre, reached out to me when lockdown began, because two of his productions that were doing incredibly well across the country had to halt, which meant that they were getting no income. And Alistair, being the good man that he is, wanted to be able to pay his actors. So I helped him along with many associates of Original Theatre Company to try and get a fundraising scheme going. By watching Habit of Art online, which was one of their productions that was out at the time. And in doing so, helping to raise some money so that the actors who were in said production got paid.
We felt very supported by OTC. There's absolutely no doubt about that. There was we were always involved in conversations.
The Original Theatre Company had a really, really difficult job, because what people were waiting for was A, for the government to make a decision, or B, for the council who own the theatre to make this decision, or C, Original Theatre to make the decision if the others didn't, because they wouldn't get any insurance. So everybody was waiting for everybody.
I hadn't heard from Alan Bennett's agent. The rights agent is actually based in LA, and deals normally with Hollywood films and such like. And we were trying a small, relatively small company from Britain. We're trying to reach him to see if we could get permission to release this film. That still hadn't come. So all of this may still at this point go to nothing.
So we very quickly had to work out what we're going to do. So my job was then, okay, we've got these films filmed. We need to find a way to get people to pay for these films, because obviously they cost a lot of money. We wanted to find a way to promote them. We needed artwork, we needed a copy. So within about the space of, I think, a week and a half to 2 weeks, if that, we built a website, just a very, you know, very simple website, but I went straight online, built a website, built a brand up called Original Theatre Online. We did lots of research into different platforms. At the time, there weren't many available for us to stream paid for content. We went to using a company called Vimeo, OTT, which is their professional platform. We had to set up pricing strategy. So we really wanted people to see the work. So we realised a lot of people were going to be worried about their jobs. So we did a real wide variety of pricing. So there was as cheap as £2.50, and then people could donate what they wanted. And that was crucial for us to talk about that, because our cast, creatives, ourselves had all overnight almost been made redundant, and the money was going to stop coming in.
Would it not surprise you to learn that there is a growing number of your devotees who would, in the nicest possible way, be happy to see you dead?
Dead? Me?
Not in Milwaukee. They love me in Milwaukee.
After all the theatres were forced to close last week, very sadly, we didn't get the chance to open a play in Eastbourne prior to a national tour. and a run in New York. However, we did get the chance to film it live so that we can share this wonderful production with everyone up and down the country and in the US. All you have to do to access it is to go to www.originaltheatreonline.com.
We released The Habit of Art. We managed to get all those rights. We managed to get the contracts cleared. We managed to build a website, which we called Original Theatre Online, a brand new platform, and a payment system. This is all new to us. We'd never done any of that before. This would be, I don't know, over a year's worth of work, I'd say, in the normal scheme of things.
I have to say I was amazed. I didn't expect it to turn around that quickly.
And so it came to the 26th, and I was nervous. We'd uploaded, the video was ready, but would it work was the crucial question. It's hard to pilot it, to test it. We didn't have time. How do you do that without sort of getting 100 people to buy it at once or to access it at once? And we didn't have that ability. So it was blind faith. And that faith didn't pay off, as it turned out. Sometimes it doesn't work. And this time we got to 7:30 p.m. or whatever time it was that we released it. And everybody then tried to access it. There'd been a lot of press, and thousands of people then went on to this Vimeo payment system and immediately exceeded either the bandwidth or the capacity for the account that we had. And it then cut off. It needed a tax form then from us to be sent in. We didn't know that. We just knew it wasn't working. And suddenly tweets, phone calls, Facebook messages start overloading my phone. People aren't always pleasant when things don't work. I think born, you know, hardened, inured by the impersonal call centers where you maybe get through to a robot as opposed to a real person. What I think most of the people calling and messaging didn't realize is that they were in fact coming through to the artistic director, who along with Emma formed a two-person band that night of dealing with hundreds and hundreds of people who couldn't get what they wanted from us. And we wanted desperately to be able to take their money and give them the production. And it was not a good start. It was very stressful. It was a really, really unpleasant evening because it felt that sort of our big launch had not launched well. So the next few days were spent picking up the pieces, repackaging the system, getting that clearance lifted from Vimeo. And we certainly sort of began to get on our way. And the following week, we released The Croft. And it was much smoother that time.
It reeks inside, we all do. We all reek to heaven.
Will you not let me help you?
No.
Enid, please!
Keep just away!
Oh my God!
Are you ready?
Alec!
What happened?
I'm warning you. This is not your concern. Don't meddle in what does not concern you.
She needs help, Eileen.
You need to leave.
In each case, I think, and I think this is still the case, even a year on nearly, that they both ended in a spirit of optimism that they were being carefully wrapped and put on a shelf rather than thrown in a bin.
So at the point in which we launched the first shows, the biggest challenges for me were around making sure all our customers could watch the shows and watch them comfortably in their homes. It was a time, I'm sure we all remember this, where we had very little experience of watching theatre at home. So a lot of my work was spent on A, making sure our audiences understood the process they were going into, so that I could be there as a customer support just to tell people how to, even just as small as telling people that how they could watch it on their TV or how they could plug it into their TV to watch. So that for me was a really big challenge.
So at that point, we have two shows up and running. Original Theatre Online is born. Unfortunately for us from a commercial level, fortunately maybe for the world in general, National Theatre Live came and announced they were going to re-release some of their big hits, starting with One Man, Two Governors, and they were going to do that entirely for free. And immediately, shall we say, sales sort of nosedived for us. at that point. Why would you pay £2.50 to see our show when you can see James Corden in One Man, Two Governors entirely for free? And lots of then other companies followed suit. So there were lots of, you know, brilliant shows released entirely for free. I think the arts in that point, you know, we were suddenly in the war, which is the only thing we had as a national emergency to compare it to. The show must go on spirit. We could keep on going. We could keep providing people with entertainment, no matter what. But now we had to close, as in we would be unsafe to stay open. We were told there was no choice. So what the arts world, we become redundant slightly, entirely. The focus naturally and rightly shifted onto those frontline workers, to the NHS staff, who were at the brunt end of things. And then to the supermarket workers and the people who were keeping on feeding the nation. And the arts community were sort of not required in that. And rightly so, I think. But then what could we contribute with? And I think the answer was, well, we can share our work and we can share it for free. And I don't know of a huge amount of strategic thought went into that decision. It was quite quick. You know, it was like, we've got to do this. We've got to give something back here. We can't just sit fallow through this. Let's be generous. But the danger that as it worked through those months is that generosity then led to, I think, audiences having the natural assumption that this stuff is, you know, it should be free. It's like turning on your TV and being able to watch, you know, digital channels for free. It's sort of, it's part and parcel of the same thing. For us, of course, it was different. We'd invested money. We had to pay a substantial amount to build the site, to get all this working. Invested literally our last pennies into, you know, getting it filmed and recorded and all these things. It was not free. There was a cost attached to it on top of the hundreds of thousands of pounds that we had lost through the cancellation of both shows. And that comes from us sitting on a massive stockpile of reserves far from it. But try explaining that, I think, to audiences, it doesn't work. So it was clear that my big plan had worked on some levels, but it wasn't going to be the Hail Mary pass that perhaps I might have hoped it could have been. There was just too much competition that was effectively undercutting us, however good the motivations were for that.
All over the UK, theatres were wrapped in pink tape today to highlight their plight. Actors, stagehands, orchestra members, set painters, directors have been sending out an SOS to the government that not only are their livelihoods in jeopardy, cultural venues from the smallest theatre to the Royal Opera House in London are under immediate threat without a substantial financial package straight away.
I mean, there is no big money in touring theatre around the country in the way that original do. It's that the original have never been steered by money. Seemingly they've never been scared of it either. But in order to keep going, you have to keep going. And suddenly having these shows stop, I just knew would put the company in real jeopardy.
So then the Arts Council announced in April that, look, we're going to do an emergency funding round for both their national portfolio organisations. Those are the companies and buildings that receive regular money and regular subsidy, but also for non-NPOs such as us, Original Theatre Company. We've never received regular Arts Council money and have in the past only received it, on a handful of occasions and never to a large degree. We've always been predominantly a commercial company. So that means we raise money and we can't afford to lose money. And we put in this bid. It was hard to know exactly what to write. It was a very short form, and there was all sorts of conflicting opinions as to, you know, what the best strategy to getting this money was. But it was a lifeline. And come the 29th of April, we didn't get it. It was a really difficult day.
When we applied for that initial grant, that first grant in April, and we didn't get it, it was painful, it was hurtful. I was really angry, incredibly angry, and not, you know, we've never been a sob story company, you know, we always fight and continue on, and we always will, but it felt so much like, you know, we were in such a dire position and you know, and we were let down.
There is only so much public money to go around from lottery or government for England's cultural scene anyway. So it is a bun fight and it is, you know, very fought over. I think mid-scale touring theatre has been underfunded or very low down the kind of big priority lists for some time as well. I think with the big NPO shake-up of a few years ago, you saw a lot of the venues losing their funding as well. So I think there was a kind of sense that some of the strategic investment decisions were going elsewhere rather than the sort of work that you were putting forward. But also, I think you're victims of your own success. I mean, I think you, whilst I know, you know, and I do know how financially your shows do, and a lot of the incredible stress in getting them financed, and you know, the ones that work very much subsidise the ones that don't commercially, and so on. I get all that, but you do. You know, you've got a story, and your story is that over 15, 20 years, however long it's been now, you've managed to grow, to invest in your company, to attract really interesting and develop really interesting talent, to go to more and more spaces, to take shows abroad, to commission new writing. And so there will be lots of people in charge of public subsidy that will look at that and go, they don't really need us.
So my constituency MP is Matt Hancock, and he was pretty busy, a busy man, courting, you know, lots of news headlines. And I wrote to him. He wrote to the head of the Arts Council. He used to be culture minister at one point. And he did get a reply, and he said, look, sorry, not this time. I didn't really expect there to be a magical answer to it, but we tried. But the short answer now was that we had to do something. If we didn't make money, if we didn't do something to bring some money into the company, we would not survive to July. If that, we had to find a way. There was a bounce back loan. Before it was called the bounce back loan, there was another loan, a government back loan, and we failed to get that loan as well. And then around end of April, beginning of May, that loan mutated into what was now called a bounce back loan. And that was a loan that we could apply for, we did apply for, and then magically, within the previous loan application had taken weeks. Those are the days when everyone was trying to call banks and there was hour-long queues. I mean, I think I spent the entire day from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. waiting to get hold of a bank, anybody in the bank, to speak to about our escalating financial worries. And then suddenly this bounce back loan came up, and it took 3 hours from applying to being approved. And then the following day, we were given a £50,000 loan, which I personally had to guarantee, but it was still a bit of money. And that money, I think, was meant to be, you know, for us to use to invest, to make sure that we would survive. So we couldn't just sit on it. I couldn't use it to pay off debt. I had to use it proactively. And then I got a call from Rachel Wagstaff.
I think we were all panicking about the state of theatre and what was going to happen to us all. I was very aware that you'd had two tours that sadly had to be pulled because of the pandemic. And I was desperately racking my brain thinking there must be a way that we can help, that we can do something, that we can fundraise, that we can keep theatres alive, theatre companies going. And then I had the idea that possibly we could do a Zoom reading of Birdsong as a fundraiser to raise money for the theatre company to keep the work alive, and so suggested this to you.
And I thought about it, and I thought, well, it probably won't work because there's too many actors involved, and over Zoom, it could be a recipe for disaster. But it got my brain whirring, and quickly I sort of thought, well, it's such a great title and I'm sure that there would be interest. The 1st of July is coming up. That's when the play is set, on the eve of the Battle of the Somme, the first day of the Battle of the Somme. And I thought that would be good timing. And then I invited my associate and then co-director on Birdsong, Charlotte Peters, who started work with me in 2013 as the assistant director, but then by the end of the final tour in 2018 was effectively directing it herself. What did you imagine it would be when, I suppose, I called you up and said we planned to do this? What did you have in your head what we'd be doing?
So I thought initially we were looking at a kind of very nicely produced Zoom reading, and it has slowly gone out of control since then. So originally I kind of pictured actors in one room, so maybe their videos would be on and off for little different bits, and maybe there'd be the hint of costume. What I would advise is if you're not an actor in this, it might be worth turning off your camera. And if you are an actor in this, you can go into, on your phone, you can click the three dots, and then on the three dots, you can go into meeting settings, and there's a button that says show non-video participants, and you don't want that button to be ticked, and it just means you won't get to see anybody who's not talking.
I remember that first Zoom table read when they were, I don't think it was a cast of 18, is it 18? And everyone was there from different productions over 6 years, already just to create something, because, you know, we were stranded in lockdown. And and I think that was a lovely, that was just great having everyone there just going, okay, let's do this. And not knowing where it was headed, but knowing that we were going to go for it.
Did I tell you, Lizette, she's married the leader of the workers at the factory. Renee was horrified, but I was glad that she found her way out.
I personally, I'm assuming some other people, was totally horrified at the kind of quality of the video, and the fact that, you know, people were sometimes 5 or 6 seconds out of sync. Everything would jump.
The kind of stark reality one evening, which is when we sat down with a group, sat down and submitted, I think it was in an email I sent to everyone, causing much panic, saying, I don't think Zoom is going to work. And suddenly this whole, what do you mean Zoom isn't going to work? And then we had to kind of figure out a way of delivering this project.
And at that point, we had committed to doing it and on Zoom. And, you know, we were paying people not huge amounts, but, you know, that £50,000 was well on its way to being spent.
Everyone goes, well, everyone's used to Zoom and all the audio of Zoom and the picture of Zoom and the stuttering. And when you start to suddenly put that into performance, you realise actually what barriers they are, and how, as individuals, we kind of tolerate this this new existence in 2020, shall we say, where Zoom, and but actually it's quite a fatiguing existence where the audio quality changes and drops in and out. And when you're trying to tell a story as intricate as Birdsong, which is where we were with that first play, it became apparent that we needed to do this better version, if you like.
And then we had this idea, I think it was... Tristan and Dom concocted it. I can't quite remember, but let's credit them. But that, what if we filmed it actually using the camera on the phone? So if you pull up your camera, here you go, the video there. If you do, and what if you filmed yourself like this and recorded it? And then if you put a green background, an actual green screen background, which could just be a bit of green fabric, it doesn't have to be something more fancy than that, then you could upload those clips and Tristan could put the scene together in the edit suite. So it would be filmed separately. Maybe the actors would be able to use the Zoom. And if you lined up the Zoom camera, you see, with the iPhone camera, we'd be able to see what they were doing. And then Dom would send a microphone so we could get slightly better sound quality. Maybe that would work. And they would upload it to Dropbox.
This is the setup I have for filming all the tunnel scenes.
which we've had to do a bit later at night. So this is the green screen, which I've rigged up in the doorway of the office, as you can see. On the other side of this green screen is the tripod with the light, and that's my tunnel. And that's about it, really.
That's the big thing to say, is the mic is directional from the front of the microphone. Yeah. So if you think of it like a spotlight pointing at your face, if the mic's pointing at your gut, it's going to not get the best of you. Mm. So getting that, the microphone pointing, you know, at your mouth. Mm. And I'd say as close as you can. Obviously, we're working with the cameras and the technology limitations of where we're at.
So how we were going to do this was beyond us. It felt hugely, we had 12 actors all over the UK, and suddenly the scale of it had gone from this to the unknown.
Cool. I mean, that's, to be honest, that's just get loads of light on yourselves and blank backgrounds. That's pretty much it. And then otherwise we're kind of at the mercy of the software, you know. Embrace it.
Well, here we are. Thanks for that. Perhaps we should go for a walk. Make the most of the place while you still can.
It's beautiful here.
Yeah, but you should see the countryside if you head towards Tien Bal. Yes, you really must take a nice long walk.
The thing to say, obviously, this is an online version, so we're going to have to change the sound world quite a bit, I would imagine, compared to the theatrical version to make it work at home. Because the conceits that we had of distance and how things bled may not necessarily transpire in the same way. So there's going to be some working on my behalf to try and work out how we translate that. But that's my problem, not yours.
And if people look like they're in the same space but sound like they're in different spaces, that totally shatters our illusion. So within this process, it's been a real kind of knitting of pulling all of those different strings together so that we create this coherent visual space, but also this coherent aural space. That people can embrace and be engaged in.
Dear Mum.
Isabel. I'm writing to you because we're about to attack.
I worry for you, Mags. What it must be like at home without it.
I'm sending this to the house in Amiens because I didn't know where else to write. I don't know where you are, Isabel. I don't even know if you're still alive.
The lovely thing about doing Birdsong Online was that we still had a rehearsal process. I mean, obviously, we were all sat at home twiddling our thumbs for 5-6 weeks prior to this. And then we got given the opportunity to read scripts on Zoom and recreate something that we'd all cared immensely about. So I think the rehearsal process of it was fundamentally what really brought it to life. I think it gave us a chance to create as a team rather than just individually.
Find a reason. Your sweetheart.
I haven't seen her for years.
She died.
No, it's too...
To watch her. You can't just give up. Sir.
Yeah, lovely. Yeah. And what I really liked about that, Tom, as well, is that we weren't losing your head too much or seeing you, which is very nice. Good.
Okay.
So, Tim, you're sitting on the edge of your seat looking into his hospital bed.
Yeah.
And, Tom, you're kind of lying down still, do we think, here, because you've kind of lost consciousness.
Yeah. Yeah, he's still very weak here, isn't he?
Yeah, for sure. I thought that was good. I think the dismissiveness of, I haven't seen her for years, I think it felt a little aggressive, and actually you can just discard the idea.
A lot of the text was obviously still, it's astonishing what you retain in your brain even after a few years. A lot of the text was still in my brain, but some of it had been rewritten. So that was a matter of obviously a relearning.
They're different people, but there's, because of the character, there's a familiarity there because you know that character. Even though it's a different person. So it's a very strange kind of twilight zone going on.
What would you say you've picked up as sort of the difference between directing in a rehearsal room and directing over Zoom and iPhone and using technology?
I think it's interesting. I was talking to somebody about this earlier. You can't, in a Zoom rehearsal room, there's no subtlety. You can't sit and let actors figure it out and breathe because you are literally there with them in that room. You know, you can't creep in at the back and see what needs to be done. You've got to be very, very present. And if you do decide to give actors the time to kind of have a think about that scene, you literally are turning your video off and muting. So it's a very strange and very direct approach.
Receiving ongoing technical advice and direction is something I've never experienced before. So having a director telling you to be closer to the camera, further away, looking one way or another, and then having makeup tell me to put more mud or less mud, and the lighting. We came up with very technical names for these lighting. There's the cold, there's the warm, there's number one cold, number three warm. I had to press the buttons up and down. And on top of that, being aware that when you're filming or when you're talking to an actor, you're not really looking at them in the face. So it's unlike theatre where you're trying to build a relationship by looking directly at your fellow actors. Not even like TV. In TV, at least you get to look your actors, your colleagues in the face. Where here, I just know that they're below me on the screen, but I'm not looking at them. I'm looking directly into a blank lens and hoping to try and create some of the emotion and relationships that hopefully we did on stage.
My dearest Jack, how are you keeping? All our thoughts and prayers are with you. Your mother, God bless her.
she says she hopes you like the cake. I'm sorry to have to tell you.
Hoffa.
It's your boy. He's not so well. Diphtheria. They've taken him to hospital.
Were there any scenes that you found particularly difficult to direct in this way?
The sex scene was very difficult to direct in this way. We had to think of a whole new approach for that because obviously in the stage production, it was very physical, as one would expect a sex scene to be. And when you're looking at different ways of doing it, and you know, bringing in Sebastian to do the narration was really, really wonderful because it gave us a chance to work out what we needed from a narrative perspective. So we knew that using Sebastian's narration would be helpful for the sex scene, but actually working with the actors to try and figure out the best way of encapsulating passion via Zoom when they're not in a room together and cannot touch at all is quite challenging, but it was fun.
Stephen was back in the house, running through the corridors, searching for the red room. What if it was like a place in a dream that remained always out of reach? He opened door after door, and finally, there she was, waiting for him. He went to her slowly, and he kissed her. She was trembling.
I feel his hands on me, his lips on my skin. I wait for someone to tell me this is wrong, but no one does. We can do whatever we want.
I think the hardest thing about the project has been that we're creating something that we've never done before. You know, we're all used to working in theatre, and some of our creative team are used to working in film, but no one's ever done this sort of hybrid that we're trying to create, where we're using actors from the stage production and the script from the stage production, but we're trying to give it a sort of a slight filmic quality.
What if the earth caves in? What if we get trapped down here? We die of thirst, or we suffocate.
Be quiet.
Maybe we should send him back, Mr. Raceford.
We're meant to be protected from the sappers. Be quiet, Tipper. They'll hear you.
So we said about this all the way May, which led into June. And then we hit June, and then there's an issue with the rights because this was a stage show, and I think Sebastian's agent, who was so supportive of the show, had wanted this to happen, but then realized, hold on, but Zoom is technically, it's a screen. It's more screen than it is theater. And the rights for the show were held by a big film company who were largely furloughed, who would need to give special dispensation. So it was sort of like, we've got to halt everything. But the point where, I mean, we couldn't halt it. We just had to continue on the knowledge that actually this rug could be pulled from under us at any point. And I didn't really tell anyone about this because there was nothing anyone else could do. But it was a worry that, I mean, gave me genuine sleepless nights, because we're putting all this hard work in and we were beginning to slowly turn a corner with how it would work. And we, again, maybe sort of dealt this knockout blow that would prevent us from ever sharing it. So that was all happening. And then we realized the scale of what we were doing, which wasn't necessarily the filming, but it was when we came to edit it. Birdsong is an epic novel. The stage show was epic. And no matter, even though we'd adapted it and Rachel had gone back and with Sebastian folks, the writer of the book, they had readapted the script and we cut it down, but it is still going to run at 2 hours, 2 hours, 20 minutes, which is feature length running time. And by the time we got to June, we were really short of time. We were releasing it on the anniversary of the battle, first day of the Somme. That day is the 1st of July. That deadline was fixed. The film, the book, the novel, the adaptation, everything is all rooted around this day, 1st of July in 1916. 1st of July 2020, we were releasing it. End of. Tristan ended up having just over 2 weeks to edit it all. Dom had, you know, that less than that time, and his job was huge.
Well, because of the nature of the way that we work and the speed that we're working at, there's so, I'm always like completely, I'm always at like 100%, and I rarely get to check back the work. But obviously, individually, scene to scene, as I'm cutting them, I could see that the performances were good, and it was, there was, you know, that certain things were working. They're kind of underground tunnel stuff. I could see, you know, I could see the potential in the footage and the kind of play. So I could see that things were really working, but I don't think it was until the night that I was supposed to deliver it that I actually watched the whole thing as a whole. And as I was watching it then, I could really see that we had something good.
We were beginning to get press coverage, quite a bit of press coverage. Timings were going a bit, for us, were working well because everything was shut down and the arts industry was in complete crisis. And this story, Birdsong, began to be sort of an example of, I suppose, a plucky company surviving against the odds, and was, I suppose, beginning to get into the national press, which added pressure because we had to deliver it.
He would have kept him, but God knew best.
Our lads are going over it morning. We'll blow our minds first. That should see to it good and proper. They reckon there's going to be a big victory. Can't be much longer now.
I haven't seen Owen yet, but I think he's just up the line from me, so I'll keep an eye on him, like you said.
So, eventually, 1st of July comes. It's midnight. We'd handed the film over, I think, 12 hours before to the press. And my phone pings with some sort of, because Original Theatre Company has its own Twitter account, and when we get tweeted, my phone buzzes. And lo and behold, the first review of it is this 5-star rave review from Dominic Cavendish in The Telegraph. And suddenly the weight sort of drops. It was the first bit of feedback I'd had on it, because no one had seen it. We'd just been locked in, and I'd sort of lost all perspective, really.
I remember watching the final thing, knowing that we'd, you know, had this kind of random green screen with creases in, and not knowing, you know, what the shots were, and kind of just lining up any lights we had in the house and just kind of going for it and trusting, you know, the director, and making sure that he was just like, just trust me, and just having to trust. Then watching the final production, was, it completely blew me away. I think it was an incredible feat.
It was followed by, from Dominic's review, by other reviews, and then when it released at 7 p.m. that evening, just a wave of, a reaction like we've never had. It was just wonderful.
Well, I absolutely loved it. I loved what came out of it. I loved the intimacy of the form.
And I have to say, I've worked on a huge number of shows over my many, many years of doing theatre marketing. And the reaction that we got when we released Birdsong was incredible. I don't think I've ever had quite that level of positive reaction come back at me from an audience perspective.
Every level, everyone I felt gave it their all, even though it was a new medium and no one knew quite what it was going to become.
And we weren't sure how people would take it. And it was such a fantastic joy to watch the cast just look excited and relieved and delighted with what was with what had been edited together and what was being enjoyed by people around the country.
The performances, my goodness, you know, they were absolutely some of the best and most emotionally driven performances I've seen in pretty much any medium by any human being. Watching that show, I was just in tears and laughter, and watched it with my wife, who I don't think I've seen her that invested in a piece of art on our big telly at home.
And then we only had 3 days to sell it. That was we'd managed to get the rights to release it, but we'd had to geolock it just to the United Kingdom, and we could just get a very short 72-hour window, which was wonderful because we may not have got it, but dreadful because just as we were getting, build ahead of steam, just as we were beginning to sell tickets, finally make money to save the company, we had to pull it. We managed to get a further 72 hours a couple of weeks later, but by which point all that momentum had come out of it, and yeah, we just weren't able to sell enough. So we had our biggest hit in 15 years, and we didn't have enough time with it after all that hard work.
We will talk and sleep and go about our business like human beings. We will seal what we have seen in the silence of our hearts. And no words will reach us.
And then we moved on to what was a smaller project in scale, but not in the size of personalities working on it, because we had Miriam Margolyes, Amit Shah, Louise Coulthard, acting in it, Mike Fentiman, who was a director I'd worked with last year and got on really well with. He was directing it. Tristan was editing it again. And this time it was going to be filmed partly on location, which turned out to be Miriam's house in Clapham, Miriam's lovely house, and partly Louise would film herself from home.
When lockdown happened, I sort of started thinking a lot about how difficult it would be to be a carer and living with someone, living with dementia at this time, and how strange it would be to either not be able to see each other or to have to sort of explain that, maybe over a Zoom call, how a granddaughter wouldn't be able to go round and spend time.
Look at you in the telly. What are you doing in the telly? You should come out of there and have a cup of tea.
I can't, Gran, not yet. We have to be extra safe and talk like this for a few weeks.
You're going to be in there for a few weeks?
No, don't worry about me. I'm all right. We have to talk like this over the screen. But it won't be for too much longer.
I think watching Rosie expanded on Birdsong in the sense that we were actually on set with a crew consisting of just me. But, in some ways it's a step even further towards film, really.
Tristan had got a bit more ambitious. We'd kind of had a debrief and said, what could we do better? And he said, look, there's this filming app. It's called Filmic Pro. This is what you need. And it was great because it turns your phone into a much more multi-dimensional film camera, but it also complicates everything by, 20 times. It's a complex bit of kit. So Louise had to get to grips with that.
So the way that watching Rosie began to develop some extra techniques to assist us as filmmaker theatre makers is that on Birdsong, we had no way of sharing the screen. So what we were seeing through Zoom was our best guess at what was happening there. You know, we couldn't see the framing that they had on their iPhones. Zoom betrays you in terms of what you see. It's kind of color. The way it portrays color and light is completely different to what you might be seeing on the iPhone. So it was all a bit blind. On watching Rosie, like I said, we were on set with Miriam and Amit, but Louise was at home and we managed to share her screen to her iPhone, which then she shared through Zoom. And although it's not totally honest, it was a lot closer than what we could do on Birdsong.
We felt it would be easier because Tristan was there to sort of, you know, press all the buttons. But iPhones, they're small and they're fiddly, and you don't have a lot of space in a house, you know, to try and get. You've got to have a lot of distance between you and the object that you're filming, and sometimes that puts you against a corner.
But what's challenging is it's not a usual way of working for actors because they're distanced from each other. They hear each other with a delay. Well, just as much technological fiddling as there is normally when you shoot, but for very different reasons.
Having Mike Fentiman, the director, I think you had to really put trust in people during this project, and he was a great person to put trust in.
A few weeks later, after some more editing from Tristan, that gets released. And I really had thought of this as a small project. Yes, it had Miriam, but the amount of press and the amount of coverage this show got, we were supporting Dementia UK, and it really hit a chord, both in terms of the press of coverage of it and then the release of it.
I wanted to work, and because I'm old, I think about Alzheimer's and dementia, and this is to help the Dementia Society.
Of course, so many people had experience of, you know, looking after elderly people, relatives, grandparents, mums and dads, people who need care, and the pressure that had put on them through lockdown. And it really tapped into something that people connected with. And we thought possibly it might be a bit slight because it was short. I think it was only 11 minutes. But Louise had written a beautifully observed piece that was complete in and of itself. And the response was wonderful. This one we released for just donations. So we never thought, we were hopeful that we might break even at best. And we obviously wanted to then make money for Dementia UK, but we did it. We managed to sort of to go into profit, and it's not going to set any records, but we will have made some money for Dementia UK. And again, it gave us, from a technical perspective, it gave us a chance to trial a new way of filming from home. So that takes us to mid-July, but just to backtrack a little bit to 3rd of July. So the 3rd of July, I went off to a hotel just to sort of get away. We, you know, 1st of July, things had reopened again, and I wanted to leave the house. I wanted to get out of this room, and I needed some time just to sort of decompress, I suppose. So I took myself away on my own, and I had a thought that, well, how do we follow Birdsong? I know we've got the next Watching Rosie project, the short one, but the response had been so positive, it'd been so good, that what do we do after that? How do I follow that? And whatever I was Googling or idly looking at whilst I was sipping some coffee in this rural hotel was, why don't we do Apollo 13? It's the 50th anniversary of the mission, and it's completely different. And actually, most of it is set, if it's nearly all set, maybe not the film, but the actual, you know, the story is set in a tiny confined space. And we can do that, or we can do a tiny confined space. It could work. And I thought about it for all of 5 minutes and then was adamant that it was the the best idea. And this is what we're doing. So I called everyone up and I said, look, I think we're going to do Apollo 13. And then they asked me about the script, and I did have to admit that there was no script and I wanted to do it and release it by October.
It's interesting remaking Apollo 13. Everybody is so aware of the film and of the story that at first I was kind of daunted by this prospect in many ways. And when this idea first came about, it was before Torben had been commissioned to write it. And so we were just talking about what the threads would be. And as I saw what the play was, I could start to imagine how it could work within the technology that we had. Because of course, it's not trying to do exactly the same thing that's been done before. It's trying to look at the idea of isolation. And isolation, of course, at the moment is so prevalent, and we're all so aware of it, that it feels thematically really well linked with what's going on currently.
As you know, we are living in very extraordinary times.
Because of this pestilence?
Exactly. And what we're hoping to do is commission a series of shows under the banner of the Age of Isolation.
Well, we're certainly living in one of those.
Breaks my heart for you guys, having to live your lives like this.
And so some bright spark in our department reminded us that no one can ever, in the entire history of our species, have felt as isolated as you three were during that 25-minute ride around the dark side of the moon.
Probably not.
I gave Torben Betts a call, and Torben had done a couple of plays for us that had gone well. Nothing like this, I think it's fair to say, but... he was at home twiddling his thumbs in Berwick-upon-Tweed. And in fact, he was writing a commission that we've got a stage show, which he promptly put down the prospect of being on stage in the near future, very slim indeed. And he was a bit of a self-confessed space geek, so he knew more than I did anyway. And I set him to work on a very quick turnaround to write this. I did say we wanted it some sort of framing device. So that's sort of some way of putting it into context. I didn't just want it with three guys. I wanted there to be a wider story. And so my idea was possibly having a press conference back on Earth, which he then took and brought in the idea of having the perspective of the present day astronauts as they are now, reflecting in an interview situation. And that was a super idea.
Yeah, the first half is partially the edited transcripts of the point up until they get to the moon, which is 3 days from launch, intercut with some interviews from the two fictional interviews from two of the remaining astronauts who are now rather elderly men, and yeah, and then the second part is the actual play. That is the invention. That is the playwright's invention. To imagine a scenario that is not attempting to be realistic, because in reality, these kind of guys don't speak. That's the whole thing. I think Neil Armstrong and his first wife divorced him because he just would never talk about his feelings. And I think that's fairly much, they're all cut from the same cloth, astronauts. They don't really emote, which is not particularly good if you're a dramatist.
We had Torben Betts writing this really interesting and relevant script.
We changed the ethnicity, I suppose, of one of the astronauts, and I was worried that that could be contentious. I hoped it would, at very least, create some positive dialogue. I felt it was crucial throughout the backdrop of all of this period has been the Black Lives Matter movement, and I felt that particularly all of us in the arts world have been asking questions about the kind of the work that we've been doing and up to now, and I felt that we had to sort of in some way address that. But I was worried, was Apollo 13 the right story to do that with? And then I just thought, well, why not?
You know, a black man in space, you know, it's not, you don't hear that often, you know, so it was good to be part of that.
So Alistair texts me saying, you know, I want to do Apollo 13. How do we do zero gravity in their bedrooms? And we kind of quickly came up with this idea that we would suspend the camera above them and lay the actor on the stool and the green screen on the floor. And they, you know, I said to Alistair, you need to cast athletes, not just actors, because they'd have to have extreme core strength. And we kind of toyed with that a little bit. And then Simon Pittman came on board, movement director, and he kind of really just elevated that to the next level.
This is me just laying on the floor. But what's interesting about it, because we filmed it like that, but as soon as you do that with it, if you imagine you can't see the background, very quickly, I could easily, whichever way I'm facing, you could quite easily believe that I'm floating.
And Simon, can you tell us about how your movement work has been helping our fantastic production?
Well, it's been really about trying to help the actors work out how to do the passive movement that would be happening in space that normally you don't have to think about. So a lot of the work that the actors are having to do is find out how to float and glide and have that inertia that you have in space without having to become too active or demonstrate that. So I think a lot of the challenge for them has been to create that natural inertia from space, but also act naturally and perform and be the characters and all of that. So that's been some of the challenge. I think also they've been working their cores quite hard. You'll see some of the shots we've done in zero gravity, they're kind of floating. And so a lot of that work is about holding yourself and shooting from angles that we wouldn't normally expect, so that it starts to trick the audiences to understand, you know, look at space and how we orientate ourselves differently.
Now, I think, that's the question, isn't it? But you can see it kind of works against the back wall. It's really badly keyed, but you get the idea of, I think we kind of go out of picture to, but that's all basically a top-down shot of me sitting on a stool. And then it's being keyed around with a background that's rotating. So that's all keyframing, that bit.
I mentioned this, the gym ball or the birthing ball. The reason why this is here is because actually what we do is we sit on this. And because in outer space, obviously, you can just float around. And this gym ball, it makes it much more fluid. So you can be just gently moving around. No one will ever know. You're actually sat on a big bouncy ball. Tricks of the trade, folks.
And I think it's also about taking things from the wrong place. So I think it's sort of, if I can probably just ignore this arm. I think it's also about bringing things down that you need from the wrong. Do you know what I mean?
It does feel quite magical, I've got to say. You're just sitting on Zoom and you're safer, it is.
But that's what it needs to be. Do you know what I mean? That's what it needs to be. It needs to be that we just take something from the wrong place.
Yeah.
From there, we sort of had days where we were at the Playground Theatre in London. So it was sort of hybrid now. It was largely at home still, but with a few days sort of on a location.
Hey guys, my name's Charlotte. I'm one of the directors of Apollo 13. I thought I'd take you on a little tour of our set. So here we are.
You can see the
chaps in the back looking at the gym level. We have Tristan, who is our director of filming and editing, and the brilliant Simon Pittman, who's doing all of our movement. Currently setting up for a shot, as you can see, and we have Salami in the middle there, waiting to do some work, and Swaggart standing by.
I think the challenges with this particular film have been very different to what I anticipated. I think I expected the challenges to be very similar to those of Birdsong. And actually what I've found is, by pushing the technology this time round, we've had a whole different set of challenges that's been, you know, a real challenge in itself to overcome. I think that learning a new kind of world of film direction is rather a challenge in itself. There's a real difference between directing on Zoom and when, you know, with Birdsong, everything we shot was kind of in this frame that you see now. Whereas what we've tried to play with Apollo is the idea of what we call Dutch angles. So when we're kind of shifting the angle, shifting the perspective, so you see things side on. And these were things that I've never, as a theatre director, had to consider how to direct, you know, film in this sort of way. So that was a challenge for myself, but for trying to kind of work out what worked best. We've storyboarded things, we've looked at shot lists, and this is kind of a new world for me. So there was that element of it, which I really got into and really enjoyed.
In terms of how the process works, you'll film your scenes with the green screen behind you, and we will add the backgrounds digitally during the editing process. So if I just cut away to some visuals, I'll just show you where we are at the moment. So as I say, we will give you a sort of working background, which is kind of what we're putting together at the moment, so that you have something to put behind you via Zoom. So when we're filming, we have a sense of the kind of environment and the space, how it's all going to work. But once we've recorded the footage of you, then in the editing process, we will then manipulate those images and move things around, change the coloring, change the brightness, etc., to sort of match the whole thing together.
We ended up filming the bulk of it from their homes. The three of them working together and doing very, very complicated, very technical work, not just the acting, but more so the setup and having to film themselves.
Also, you're set on 48 frames per second right now. So you need to go into that cog and make it sure it's 24.
We've got a little bit of feedback there. That's where the directors talk to me there. And that's what actually does the filming. And that's how I see what I'm filming. And that's my bed in the background. So that's how the magic happens.
Finding that chemistry was really difficult, because you just had to hope that you were looking at each other when you looked at them, that you were reacting to them in the way that they needed reacting to, because it would all show up on the screen so quickly if you looked like you were in three different bubbles. And of course, we're supposed to be in a baked bean can together.
Understanding who's where, because it takes a slight different angle of your head and it can throw off the whole read of the scene. So that also was quite important. So it was learning about, you know, the importance of like looks and how subtle it should be within a type of frame.
That's good.
Are you?
Yeah, I'm okay. My time has been and gone.
We also had the addition, a slight challenge with the costume for the spacesuit, because there is only one spacesuit in the whole of the UK that's an absolutely perfect replica. And so what we had to do, particularly during these COVID times, was film each of the actors in a green screen studio in the spacesuit. And then the spacesuit went away for 3 days to be sterilized before the next person could be in it. So it meant that we filmed in a very different way. We've pieced together different sections, whereas usually what we do is we have everybody filming each other at once.
Is Siobhan and Sam and Tom, as we finish our shoot at the playground. What time did you get up today, Siobhan?
5 a.m.
How many times have you done that?
3.
How are you feeling?
Sleepy.
Very good. Where are you off to now?
Leicester.
Okay, and can you explain why you've done this?
I don't know, why have we done this? No, we've done it so that we can get a spacesuit, the only spacesuit in the UK, from the Midlands, from NASA in Leicester, down to West London. So me and Siobhan have been getting up at 5 a.m. and coming down here for the filming.
Okay, and Siobhan, how did you think it was all looking, your hard work with the costume?
Absolutely beautiful.
Of course. So anyways, that was Apollo 13 that was filming. We had 2 days filmed like a short film in a rehearsal studio with Jeff and Philip, who played the older actors, and Poppy, who returned from Birdsong. And that all went swimmingly. It was a relief, a blessed relief. We were all in masks. It was socially distant, and that was a pain. But look, it's just to be working in a room was joyous and exciting. And I think we wrapped it on the 3rd of September.
Tom Hanks, of course, you know, had a, you know, much, much easier task than me in that he didn't have to play Jim Lovell at the age of 94, which he is now. And I will carry to my grave the conversation that I had with you about that, saying, you know, me blithely saying, well, do you think there's going to, you know, what are we going to do about makeup? And you saying with all innocence, do you really think you're going to need it? And I think I really, really do. I look 94. So as it turned out, we had some extremely good makeup, which was so difficult to get off, I had to go home on the tube in it. So a little foreshadowing of what it's going to be like in the care home. You know, people giving you their seat and whatever, looking at you with sort of contempt.
You can see nothing above you, nothing below you.
Until you make daybreak on the moon.
So come on, you must have said something to each other.
Very little.
In terms of my editing timeline, it was just such a... probably the lesson for me is to kind of sort out the workflow, but it was just such a cumbersome beast. And all the backgrounds were much more... the backgrounds on Birdsong were just constantly stationary. And now and then we'd play with them a little bit, but the backgrounds on this, because it's zero gravity, you're like constantly turning, and there's windows in the background, so you had to comp in space and try and create a reflection, and, you know, all within, you know, a ridiculous time scale.
The process largely comes from seeing the footage and just getting an insight into what the world is and what the visual world is, and then trying to respond to that as immediately as possible. I find the longer I try and mess around with things, the worse it tends to get. So try to respond as immediately as possible. And then once you have a theme, once you have a sort of musical world for the play, just to keep rolling with that and then extend it out through a given scene. That's certainly always been my process. I'm not someone that can just keep changing something as I work.
Looks so peaceful, doesn't she?
Yeah. That's from the dishes, you can't hear all the screaming. You can't sense all the pain.
But to give you an idea of how I'm having to work, so each of those is individual lines. Obviously, there's Sophie's music along the bottom in the blue, the kind of turquoise blue. The boys are at the top.
Great. And is that including the epilogue as well, Sophie?
Oh, yeah. New epilogue. So, I had a slight nightmare trying to write this for some reason. I was trying to write it last night. And I just couldn't see the wood from the trees, and I was just not really making any sense. So I stopped, and then I thought, well, I'll be able to write it in the morning. It was a bit better this morning, but it wasn't like I'm nailing this. So I have written something, Alistair, and it is more rousing. It has strings. It's very low level, but it has some strings in it for the second half, and it makes a bit more sense melodically. Sorry, it's not... Sorry not to be more positive about it.
I'm sure it's better than you're making it sound.
There's so many amazing scores that have already been written for things set in space that, you know, obviously those references are all there in your head as you're writing, whether you want them to be or not. So it's trying to be authentic and trying to be authentic to the play and to this particular project, you know, has to remain paramount in your mind.
Technical side. One of the big things I think from creating a world in Apollo is expectation. One of my nervousnesses about going into Apollo is everybody has an opinion on the space race. You've got the people that come out of the woodwork that go, that's the wrong sound, that would not have been the alarm. You've got the people that are going, that's not how I pictured it in my head, and trying to marry the expectation of this environment alongside some historical accuracy to that environment. and marrying all of those things together, I think, for Apollo was the bit for me where, I guess, nervousness, trepidation, but quite exciting. But it is this kind of world about going, how far do you, how crackly do you make the voices and automate all of that process? Because we've all got this expectation of hearing historical Apollo recordings, which are actually quite degraded in what was coming back through the airwaves. But of course, to sit and listen to that for an hour and 10 minutes is not something. Again, we're back to this world of going, what's an audience's expectation?
Are you worried about the schedule that we've got, bearing in mind we're always slightly worried about time? Are you properly worried about time? Or are you worried in the way that we're always worried about time?
Edging towards properly worried.
What can we do to... Is there anything that can be done to ease worry? What can we do? Because I don't think we can... I can't delay things, the launch.
No, I mean, it is what it is. I think it's, again, we have to not accept things as they what they are. I don't mean it like that, but there's going to be some compromises because it was filmed in people's homes again, I think. Do you know what I mean? Which is fine, because that's the format. I think we have to embrace. Don't get me wrong, it's not like we've suddenly got what's his name's microphone pointing at the floor.
Right.
We're not in that territory.
Yeah, I mean, I think that we've been very clear with our audience about the form, and we've always been very clear with ourselves about the form. And I totally understand, and you know, you're always going to hear things as well that actually the average ear might not hear. But I think that those compromises you're talking about, you know, we should absolutely be celebrating the form and not worrying too much that it can't be feature film kind of standard.
October the 8th gets released. I'm really nervous about this one. It's the second album, so to speak. Expectations were much higher this time.
I saw it this morning at 6 a.m. and yeah, I think it's wonderful. I think what we've done, and considering as well that people still don't seem to realise it's all done on an iPhone, it's all done on like a, you know, a Mac type thing, or it's just incredible.
It's different. It's a very different production, but I think there's something really special about it. But what's lovely is that you've now, it's not just the technical risks, you're taking creative risks with it as well, even more than you were doing with Birdsong. I think there's that experimentalism in there again. The performances stand up again, so it wasn't just a one-off thing with Birdsong. These are different actors, largely, but doing, but still, you know, clearly the directing is working in this format, which many would wonder how. You know, you're not even in the same county as some of these performers, but you're getting extraordinary performances out of them, which I think is great.
I had no idea that Tristan's magic would be as thorough as it was. And Sophie and Dom's score and soundtrack have just added so much to it as well. Yeah, I was absolutely blown away by the final result.
Again, Apollo 13 was just, I said it again, but it blew me away, because I watched it and I said to, you know, everyone I knew, you've got to watch this because you've not seen anything like this before.
From the music to everything just came together, and oh my God, how he cut it and moved. It was like a film. I was blown away, and I was very, very proud to be a part of it, even more so. I was just like, wow. They did it again, but they did it even 10 times better than the last one.
It went down very well. Maybe space is a bit more niche over here in the UK, particularly in the theatre world. There's not a lot of space plays out there, and our audience is still predominantly theatrical. They're a theatre crowd who tend to support and watch our work. So it's taken a bit more cajoling, I think, to get people engaged with us, but it's had brilliant reviews, and the feedback has been, again, fantastic, and that's all thanks to the work of this amazing team of people who have kind of helped make that happen. And whilst all that was happening, 4th of July, the day after I got my bright Apollo idea, the government announced this £1.57 billion bailout for the arts. And that bailout sort of, there's been a build-up of pressure from the arts community as we sort of saw all our jobs, the whole industry, just vanishing sort of in front of our eyes.
I think the arts generally has never been in a worse situation, perhaps since, you know, the theatres were all shut down in the 18th century. I think the magnitude of it is still not really understood.
Several theatres that I've been lucky enough to play at in my career are struggling to fund themselves and to keep staff on. So we're seeing so many cuts. So many theatre companies are, you know, if they're not putting out work, they're not getting any money. And the industry in whole has been decimated. There's probably a percentage of about 0.9% percent of actors in the country are working at the moment.
This bailout was announced. It was much welcomed. It was much needed, but not really was it clear at that point how that money would see work its way down to, I suppose, us and freelancers. But it did, I suppose, buoy up the community and kind of make us feel that we would be returning. August time, we were given the application form and we were obviously going to apply for this. It was crucial. We could apply for anywhere up to about £3 million. So it was trying to pitch how best, what we needed, what was the right way of doing it. Just to put it in context, I mean, that sounds, £3 million is a huge amount of money, but the total cost of just one touring show is sort of 1.5 million. And so we were never dreaming of applying for that level of funding, but I think we ended up applying for just shy of £200,000, which is a lot of money, but it's the cost, the upfront costs of just one show, just to get it to the first night. And we'd already had two of those shows cancelled in 1 year. So it's when you put it against in context, it's not as much as it sounds, but it would be crucial to see us through. So I knew how important this was, and we were trying to film Apollo and, you know, dealing with all manner of, you know, normal day-to-day personal life kind of issues that intercede as they did with all of us. And this crucial application that we had to get right.
This money that we've applied for from the Arts Council is very, very much needed. But yet again, in terms of the story of our company and doing the actual copy for the Arts Council form, you know, OTC does have a very good story. We've been adapting and surviving for, you know, 15 years, and to be able to say how the how COVID has affected us, we can tell that story and we can show what we've done. The problem, as always, being a commercial theatre company, is that, you know, when it comes to accounts and things of that nature, commercial companies that don't really fit into the Arts Council ABC, you know, we have many companies and we work with a variety of different co-producing partners, and that is a harder story to kind of to try and navigate and try and get our way through.
And then the following week, it was Friday, the 16th, of October. And we got a message, an email from the Arts Council. And it said, the day before, it said, you will hear at 9 a.m. whether you have got this grant. And of course, that's a sleepless night, isn't it? I mean, why tell us that? Why give us that? And it's the same with every artistic director, chief exec up and down the country, they all had those messages. It's a lifeboat. That's what it is. It would allow us to survive. If we didn't get it, I really don't know what we'd do. And as I said, I really did. It was a 50-50 call. I didn't know. Nobody knew. And 9 o'clock comes. I'd taken myself off for breakfast because I thought, well, if we're going to get good news or bad news, let's be somewhere. Let's make an event of it. So I was out for breakfast on my own, and this message comes up at 8:55, and we get the funding. It says we've got it, and I mean, relief, ineffable, hard to describe. We have not received a lot of good news like that in our 15 years. I mean, I can name the number of times we've had funding on one hand. It's been a real battle, and so for that to come through was hugely welcomed, a big relief. And if nothing else, I think just testament to the work that my team and I take myself out of this really, but Tom and Emma, Sam particularly, and then all the creatives and freelancers who had worked to make this stuff happen. And I see it, you know, try and get that money to them as much as possible.
Where do you think online or, well, online theatre and in our case, original theatre online, where do you have it? Do you have any sense of what direction it's going in?
So I think online theatre is going to, has really going to change how we move forward, I think, in this industry. I think no longer, even just in the fact from an access perspective, from a touring perspective, you know, suddenly within 6 months, the world of theatre has become a very different place. And obviously, you know, all of us are desperate for the theatre that we know and the live element to be able to come back and to be supported, because it's one of the greatest things that we produce, in my opinion, produce as a country and as a human race. Theatre is, I think we can't live without that live, beautiful art form that we create. But what I think the having to move stuff online and create either online hybrids like Birdsong or stream productions like the National Theatre or the Old Vic or our productions of The Croft and the Habit of Art has meant that our work can reach further?
It's a good question. I ultimately think there is a future in this type of work. I think there is an obvious moment that we are in, which is related to the coronavirus lockdowns and restrictions. And then there's that kind of invention and necessity, you know, artists always find a way. And I think this is a testament to that, is a collective of people that have come together and gone, we're not going to be stopped by some pandemic. On we go.
I think the time is there for some real experimentation. I think people's attention spans on this kind of platform is probably longer than we'd thought. I think the reach that you can have is enormous.
Each project that has happened under the umbrella of original seems to have moved on in some way and started to explore different ways. It's not just repeating a template. It seems to be, how could we do it differently? How could we, let's do a piece in space. Let's do a period piece that alternates between 1918 and 2020. These are all new things. It's not just churning out a photocopy of a photocopy of a photocopy.
I don't know whether it would continue. It depends on an audience perception. Like, there's something about the way we've got used to screens as audience, but also as family members and friends now. We're so much more used to screens than we were in April. So maybe there's an ongoing storytelling this way that, you know, it's not as glossy as TV or film, but it's something else.
The fact is that the ecology of doing online shows, this is not suddenly, you know, OTC is not turning into a Netflix streaming provider or providing that kind of content. I mean, what we are doing is very niche and is really cool and interesting, but fundamentally, you know, we are a theatre company, as it says in our name, and that the money that we get in from doing this, you know, it is so much work to put this on. I know you yourself haven't slept in like the last 3 days and stuff. And it takes so much time and so much effort from everybody, such a team effort to get this put on, that when you see the numbers coming in, you're like, okay, well, hopefully we're going to break even, or hopefully we're going to get a little bit, you know, of money or whatever. But there, you know, we're finding more and more, it is a very niche market. And so whilst it's fine to run alongside our business, it can never overtake our main business.
I really hope, you know, that theatre reopens as soon as possible and that we can recover. But I think this will be an interesting sideline that might continue alongside theatre. Or even complement it.
What I think this has done, though, is created a platform that enables, as we hopefully go back to live performance, is it's created a platform where it allows individuals to express and create work and demonstrate their skill sets, whether that's performance, whether that's design, in a very cost-effective and affordable way that enables them to deliver something that isn't live performance, but isn't film. It's that kind of I think at the moment we're in this kind of, and maybe the terminology is wrong here, but I think there is a very interesting version of this type of work where we see a fringe festival of online creation work, because I can see a very beautiful thing, and Alistair's at heads winding now going, oh yeah. But you know, where you invite theatre companies to submit pieces that are no longer than half an hour long. It's a great way to showcase performance actors. It's a way of, it's, you know, it's all of those things of talent, of sound people and video people and artistry and direction. Yeah, it's all in there. And it's a really, I think it's a very interesting platform that could develop something that enables people to create work with things they own, you know, relatively cost effectively, and get their work out there in a way that hiring a theatre, hiring a space, and some of those financial constraints don't necessarily always allow.
We've already onto our next project, which Philip Franks, another of our associates, has adapted. It's a ghost story this time. It's called The Haunting of Alice Bowles. And again, we're taking another step forward in how we're going to make that. And it comes out in December. It's been a ride this year. It's been, I suppose, a year that none of us will forget. But I do feel quite proud that we have managed to create work at all, and that maybe we have sort of created an example, or we have led the way in a small way with this online work. Maybe we have created our own sort of road out of disaster, and we haven't done that up until we got that money, but up to that point we've done it all off the sweat of our own backs, picked ourselves up and found a way through with a bit of good old-fashioned theatrical ingenuity. And I'm proud of that. I'm proud of that, and I'm proud for the company is still kicking and screaming when we can muster the energy. So who knows where we'll go next year. I have plans. I've got ideas. Hopefully we'll be back on a stage. But I think we will continue with this new form of theatre or film, this cine theatre, this little revolution that not nearly enough people subscribing it to call it a revolution. I don't know what we'd call it. It's a gathering so far, but maybe it will grow into something bigger than a gathering, and we will have two contrasting strands of work. And the rest, I suppose, is yet to be written. Thank you.